All right. Hi, guys. How are you all today? Can you guys hear me?
I can hear you.
Yeah. Can you guys hear me? If you can hear me, just write down in the comment section so that we can go along with our program today. Can you hear my voice? Loud and clear? Guys, are we getting any comments? Not yet. Okay, waiting for your comments still. Hopefully this time everybody can hear loud and clear. I'm trying to make the best. So, be patient. Loud and clear. Okay, now I'm going to test my drums. With Daniel playing the bass, I will introduce the man on the bass. So just tell me if you guys hear us loud and clear. Just the bass and drums. So, can you hear my voice and the music? The drums and the bass?
Can you hear me?
And Daniel's voice? Can you guys hear us? Both musically, with the music and with our vocals and drums. Daniel, can you hear me?
I can hear you loud and clear, my bro.
Are we getting any comments? All clear?
Awesome.
Loud and clear. That's great. All right. Thank you so much to everyone that is tuned in to this YouTube channel. Thank you so much for your time. I hope you all had a okay Monday. And welcome back to Monday Night Blues with Tony David. Okay, today I've got a very special guest. I'm so honored to be having him here live.
Honored.
So I'm going to introduce to you the man on the bass. He plays the keyboard. He does a whole lot of good stuff. So, and I happen to be playing with the band called Nine Lives. I'm so honored to play with them. So, without wasting much time, I'd like to introduce to you Mr. Daniel Liano Guerzo. Hi, Dan.
Hi, man. Thanks,
how are you? Yeah.
With the COVID going on, it's hard to meet up with all our good buddies.
I know. It is. Oh, my God. But how are you doing otherwise?
Well, we haven't been doing much. We've been doing some char kway teow and baked fish and stuff with my brothers. And, yeah, just to keep afloat, I guess. Keep afloat. It's not easy, but we're trying.
Yeah. And before we even begin, would you like to say something to our musicians out there who are also going through the tough times?
Yeah, man. All I can say is, you know, keep the faith. Keep on doing what you're doing, you know, and try our best to keep afloat. Whatever it takes, do whatever you can until it all subsides, God willing, you know. To all of you out there, selamat berjuang lah, like everyone will say.
Thank you. That camera is there, so anything you face the camera is off.
I'm not used to this.
Never mind. You get used to it now.
You don't act funny.
That's what they say. Normal baru. Normal baru.
New norm.
Okay. All right. Thank you, Dan, for coming here tonight.
All right.
And we have been playing for at least 6 months now. So whatever we are doing, it's just coming right straight to you. We have never rehearsed nothing. We are just
winging it.
And then we'll go into the section soon after this. Okay? So, then, are we ready to just groove?
Okay. We'll try something, whatever you want.
All right. Let me give you the groove then. Okay. Two. Thank you.
Yeah.
Before we move along, I'd like to say thank you to two of my good guys who've been helping us, helping me in achieving this live stream with the audio, the video, and all that stuff. I'm going to introduce Pavin and Sat for helping me. One day I'm going to have another camera just for them so you guys know what they're doing.
Yeah, okay.
Thank you to them. Okay, then. I've got a few topics that I want to discuss with you and with all the musicians or anybody who wants to be a musician or who wants to know about music, okay? There are a few topics that I want to talk to you about regarding how to lock with a bass player or how does a bass player lock into a drummer. Does the drummer have to have a certain thing? Does technique play an important role and some other questions as well.
I think it boils down to all the elements.
Right.
You know?
Now, if my first question to you will be, what do you, or what does a bass player, or for the fact you today, what do you look in a drummer to where you can actually lock him or dial him together with the drummer?
I mean, it all depends on the music. For me, the music is first. And depending on the situation, if you're backing an artist or even, like, say, we're in the same band, whoever is singing, we try to back them up the best as we can. And in order to do that, I have to understand the capabilities of who I'm playing with also, which makes a big difference. You know, if they can't do certain things, so I have to find other ways to try and contain the tightness of the band. Yeah. So, like, through the years of playing, when I had different drummers that I played, some are really good, some are really bad. So, what do you do? As a musician and as a bass player, sometimes when you know a lot, it doesn't mean that you go bluffing all the way.
Yeah.
And the drummer can't do anything, so what's the point?
Yeah.
And it doesn't coincide with the music and the backing of the artist.
And likewise also for drummers, who wants to play the
bass
and then don't give a room for the bass player.
Or the artist.
Right, correct, the artist himself.
The song. The song is the key.
Right. That's very nice, Dan. Now, if to give you another question,
Well,
guys, if you guys also have any questions regarding how do you guys play together, how do we create parts, and anything that you want to know, it can be a short lesson or something to share with how do we actually get the music going, how do we rehearse, how do we play with the bass player and the drummer, how do we play without the bass player and the drummer when we are at our own homes practicing and all that stuff.
And also to point out that we can't do any covers now, so we're just gonna wing it and give you a few examples.
Correct. So I know that there's no request of any song. I'm so sorry.
Yeah.
But we'll get the hang of it soon. Okay then. Now, my first question to you, even regardless of the bass, Daniel is also known to be playing keyboard bass, where he can play the keyboard parts, the piano, whatever, not with his right hand, and his left hand is doing the bass drums, and I like that a lot from him, and I don't think so it's easy, so I'm going to ask Daniel to demonstrate some of the passages or some of the sounds that he can create just by playing keyboard bass.
Okay.
What are you going to call today?
Right now, I'm 26 watts, the Roland XPS-10 with a billion preset. So I'm going to try it out with a looper, which is the Boss RC-505, right? See what happens.
Fantastic, Dan, very nice, very nice. Well, as you can see, he's so talented. He knows how to play almost all the instruments.
Not really all, but this is the rhythm section.
All right. Okay, Dan, is there anything that you like to share to our musicians or anyone who's watching our channel today?
Since we're on the topic of rhythm section, it's very vast, rhythm section, when they say. Sometimes, you know, in a trio, rhythm section definitely is just the bass and the drums. And then I feel like if we play in a slightly bigger group, you know, where it's a quartet or anything, the keyboard player or guitarist sometimes are really part of the rhythm section as well. So, when we are, because we are a four-piece band, the Nine Lives, we have a singer, a guitar player, great guitar player, a good buddy of ours, Jude. Mr. Jude Bensing.
Yes.
Yes, he can sing. His name is supposed to be Jude Kenching, but...
You'll get there.
Okay. So, and there's Tony. So, there's only the four of us. So, sometimes I have to double up with the bass and the keys. And being the power trio, as I feel we are, the rhythm section is just Tony and I, basically. So, we have to come up with ways to really make things happen. You know, like sometimes the song can be a really simple song, and as I told you earlier, we can't do cover songs. So maybe we can, you know, demonstrate a little bit on how the song will be a simple song before we actually change the whole rhythm and it totally becomes another song. Mm-hmm. You know, which we normally do most of the time. So that's the power of the rhythm section. We can actually change the way the music is, you know, the feel of the music, we can change it however we want. And that's the beauty of having a good rhythm section.
Thank you, Dan. Can we demonstrate?
Okay. Just a basic beat. If the tune is going like this, and Tony and I will come in, maybe, and we embellish a little bit more. To have a really good rhythm section, I feel like you have to have a sense of music first of all, and listen to your band members when they are playing. Yes, if he's a trio, the guitar player, you know, he can roam anywhere, but the rhythm section, we can control the whole music, you know.
Right. Okay, and then one more question. Is technique important to create a tight rhythm?
Oh, for sure, for sure. So you have to have all your chops or whatnot, but when you play to the music, you have to contain that thing. You can't just be showboating all over the place. The song has got to be the song first.
Right.
And then with your capabilities, we try to make the song better.
Okay.
That is the prerogative. Yeah.
Okay. Do we have any questions from any of our friends?
Viewers?
So far, everything is okay. You guys still can hear it? All good? Okay. Okay, sure. Okay. And then, if I have another question for you,
mm-hmm.
That would be, how do you practice at home without a drummer?
Yes. Pretty boring, I would say. But I would go like...
Do you set a loop like on your... Is there any loop?
I'm not sure if there's a loop here. I can try it out. Yeah, it'd probably be something like this.
Alright.
And I'll just practice, you know, like... And then I'll try to change it. top division. Something like that.
Very nice. So you set different tempos and different grooves as well?
Different grooves, different tempo, and most important thing is like we try to do the subdivisions according to the feel of the song.
Right. And when you are learning any songs, any favorite song that you have, how important is lyrics to you to be able to be playing the kind of music? Do you just listen to music, or you also listen to the lyrics?
I think everything is important. We have to take into context what the song means and how we interpret the songs with our capabilities. You know, we try to do the best we can all the time. Yeah, but by listening a lot to all sorts of genres, all kinds of styles, you know, you get that feeling, you know, and we do the best we can all the time. But the lyrics is very important because it can dictate the way the feel of the song is going.
That's very nice.
Yeah.
Thank you, Dan.
Yeah.
Okay, before I go along to more questions, why don't we just play along with that? Why don't we just create a music? Why don't we create something?
Tyler, what we're going to do, bro?
Okay.
What are we going to do?
Anything.
Let's see,
Right. Wow. That's very nice. Okay. Before that, Ben, we got some comments coming in.
Yes. All right. Finally.
Finally.
They want what? Lemon tree. Lemon juice. But,
who is this? who's asking for lemon tree? Dream Journey Vincent. All right. We don't have lemon tree.
We can't do covers.
We can't do covers. As I mentioned earlier, so this is basically just right. It's just our creativity that's coming right now at this time. There's no
plan,
improvise.
Yeah.
Okay. So I'm so sorry we can't do lemon tree.
And the subject is about rhythm section.
Sorry. Okay. If you really like and digging into this channel. We're going to be talking about a lot more stuff with different acts and probably a band, hopefully, in the future. And if you like this kind of stuff, please don't forget to give me a like and share it to your friend.
Yeah.
And then to subscribe.
Yeah, man. Support.
Yeah, we got to support one another. Okay? Now, moving along. Yes? One solo by both. Okay. Why don't I give the sign to Dan to do whatever he wants to do? Sorry? Okay, Helen David is requesting us for us to do a solo. But okay, before we go to that, let's get a bit more information out there because our main topic today is how do we lock in correct drummer or to a bass player. Okay, Dan, anything you would like to add? Or before that, how can I ask you this question?
Mm-hmm.
What made you to get into keyboard bass? And how do you actually do it? Why did you do it?
Well, to be honest, before the band that we are in right now, we used to be a 7-piece band. And when the band broke up, there was only 4 of us with a guitar player, my brother, myself, and Joy. So I had to do all the programming. Mm-hmm. I used to use the Roland MC50, if you believe it, with the diskette, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And we used to program all the keyboard parts because I could already play keyboard fairly little, but I knew how to program, so I used to program most of the songs, and that got me into keyboard playing, because one night, you know, the sequencer just died on me, and we were playing it halfway, and I switched on the bass, and I started going, like, out of the blue, you know, something like this, like. So even though it was sequenced, but when it died, you felt naked, you know. And then the guitar player is just plucking, you know. And then the drummer is just going, where I was not doing anything, and everybody was looking at me, and because I could play a little bit, so I just went. And I said, hey, it sounded so cool, I better work on it. So I've been working on it ever since.
Wow, very nice.
So it happened, you know, out of the blue.
I'm so happy to hear all the stories from Daniel Grezzo, how he started. This is the best time, actually, for all of us to get to know our local musicians and get to know them well. If you miss this, whenever you go to YouTube, you can know who is Daniel Grezzo and all the other musicians that I will feature them in the near future. Thank you so much, Dan, for sharing your experiences.
It was a pleasure being here.
With me still. All right. There's a comment coming in. Yes, start.
We can't do any covers. Anything, this kind of songs, you got to ask Peter Frankfurt. Why?
Maybe we can do some covers, but maybe in the future we try to do. Come on, call. Are you? Okay, I'm not really good in Konoko, but I remembered Madan from Lokap. He used to teach me this Konoko, which is in a cycle of it's five note grouping, I think. So it went like I don't know how to sing that Konoko line very well, but. I actually don't want to do it. I'm not good at it. Tagatom, tagatom, tagiratom, takatakita, takatakita, takatimi, tagatom, tagatom, tagiratom, takatakita, takatakita, takatimi, tagatom, tagatom, tagiratom, takatakita, takatakita, takatimi, takatakita, takatakita, takatimi, takatakita, takatakita, takatimi,
takatakita. All right.
What I used to remember, I used to play the line, so. Do this kind of lines.
Awesome.
Before. All right. Thank you so much for that, and I'm so sorry I couldn't do it very well, but yeah. Now. Okay. Okay. From who's that? From Ed. Ed has a question for you, Dan.
Oh,
was your first bass guitar?
Well, my first bass guitar was an Ibanez Roadster. Not rod. I'm thinking about fishing now. Ibanez Roadster, which I eventually traded with someone else. And then I got my second bass, which was an Ibanez also. I still have it. It's
a four-string.
It's a four-string. I still have it till this very day. It's called Ibanez X-Star. Yeah. AX,
not X.
Okay. I still have it after, you know, like 30 over years of playing, and I still have it. It's amazing, it still works.
And how many basses do you have at this moment?
Only one. How many drumsets do you have?
I just have one.
Yeah?
Yeah, as you can see, that's it. Thank you to Roland as well, Roland into Pacific, especially to Dennis for. Helping me, giving me the drums for me to use, and thank you to Connie as well. So thank you to Roland Acid Pacific and Daryl Pereira Holdings for the audio equipment that we have for tonight.
Amazing,
amazing, amazing. All right, we got more comments. Yes. Okay, who's this question from?
Chanel.
Chanel. All right. Chanel has asked us a question on how do we actually play odd times, is it?
No.
right then?
Well, it can be any timing or time signature, but basically where the pulse is, you have to lock in. It can be, you know, 4-4 or whatever, you still got a lock in,
correct?
It can be a different time signature, whatever that you play, which I don't really do as much, you know, unless I have to, then, you know, I don't want to be calculating while I'm playing and having a good time. Some people like it, some people don't, you know.
Yeah, that's what I used to know about odd timing as well. I always believe in counting. That means when I'm learning something, I must always be able to count what I'm playing. I don't want to be guessing in the beginning, right? So if I'm taking a simple groove, right? I count 4-4 first before I go into 6-8 or a 5, okay? So if I'm doing this, 1-2-3-4, 1-2-3, if this is the beat I'm doing, what we're doing in 4-4, and I'm counting 1-2-3-4, 1-2-3, and if I want to do 5, I just have to count to 5 and come back to the 1. But the same beat, for you to get an idea on how to play odd time, right? This is my understanding, right? So, again, in 5, 1, and 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 1, right? That is how I used to learn it. Then when I started listening to some of the songs that I've got odd time signatures, such as, you know, I used to listen to Porcupine Tree, you know, where Gavin Harrison used to play that song called Sound of Muzak, right? That song has got a nice groove to it, and it's in, I think it's in 7, if I'm not mistaken. So once you are familiarized with a melody, you know how the melody is, then you will get there as well. So counting is also important, and also listening. Listening is also a very important part of practice, or time, or anything that you want. Right?
Yeah. Basically, it's still, you got to lock down to the groove, whatever time can be said.
Yes. Okay. Any other comments, sir? He's asking to who? Okay. There's a comment from Joshua Ambrose. He's asking, who are one of our biggest
influences? Who?
Just one or a few? One. Who will be your biggest influence?
I think it would be my late grandfather, Mr. Alfonso Soriano, who started the ball rolling for the few generations that came after him, you know. Like my uncles, my mom, dad, everyone plays music. And when we were growing up, it was like, wow. You know, it was a norm for me growing up in a household full of musicians. And I thought it was a normal life, like everybody's life, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And I used to go to my friend's house and everybody's like, why it's so quiet? But when I go back to my own home, it's like so noisy and there's music everywhere. I always thought it was a normal thing for people to have that.
Mm-hmm.
Until I grew older and I said, oh no, we are a special family, and you know, and everybody's into music, fun, laughter and everything. And it always goes back to my late grandfather. So whenever I do something, I always think about him and you know, what his name stands for.
That's nice. That's very nice. Okay, for me, the main influence, the one and only influence that got me into, I won't say drumming, but music, would be my my late brother, Surin, who has just left us last year. And he was my biggest influence because I saw how he used to play the drums in the church when we used to attend church before, and he could not even play the drums. He used to always just watch these drummers leading the praise and worship and all. And then suddenly, when there was no more people there, there was a broken stick. And then he took the stick, he went right to the drums, and he can already groove. Wow. So he has got this gift. So when I saw him playing, I always told him, I said, wow, I can play a bit of guitar, I can hold a few chords, but drums is so tough because of the coordinations, right?
Correct.
But he's my biggest influence for me to get into music and especially into drumming. Then came all my other idols. Locally, Louis Pergasam, Jerry Felix, John Thomas, Steve Nanda, Arthur Kram, and many drummers out there, I cannot remember all their names. And if I want to go internationally, we got Steve Gere, we got Vinnie Kalita, we got Steve Smith, Giorgio Meyer, and everybody.
Yeah.
Right there.
The list goes on and on.
Yeah.
Even the same for first bass players and all that. But most of the time, I like listening to, you know, like those who really lock in, you know,
right.
What
about locally? Do you listen to anybody locally?
There's a lot of bass players out there.
Can you name me a few then?
One of my biggest influences is Abang Norman. Norman used to play for Sheila, and he used to be my housemate.
Nice.
So, a lot of you, Andy Peterson, you know, who I always look up to, one of the living legends, he's still kicking people's asses. Few upcoming ones, you know, like Gideon Yogan, a good friend of mine, my brother, who I admire, Mr. Don Alfonso as well. He plays a mean upright bass, and, you know, crazy great. You know, these younger ones, they just come out like mushrooms, and it's amazing. But only a handful I can see that will withstand, you know, the test of time.
Right, right. Thank you. Thank you, Joshua Ambrose, for your question. Next question. Who is this from? Okay, we got another comment from Nathaniel asking, playing in pocket, does it mean locking?
It's both. You know, locking and in the pocket. Pocket is a different ballgame.
Whether we're going to play on time or...
Yeah, in the pocket, you will know when you record yourself, then you know whether you're in the pocket or not. That's why it's very essential to record yourself all the time. You know, I per se, it's not 100%, but still trying after so many years. It's not an easy thing. There are some people who just lock in naturally. Some people have to work at it, and I think I'm one of those millions who have to try.
Because it never stops. So you always try to learn to get better at what we do.
Yeah, but to answer your question, it is not the same. It's not the same. You know, in the pocket, you gotta work at it, or you gotta have it. You know.
Yeah.
It's not easy.
Yeah. Correct. Yeah. Is there any more comment? Okay. Who is this question from? Okay, Ed has another comment asking me if I have a basic guide for tuning. Unfortunately, yes, I know a basic tuning method, but because I'm showing all my playing using an electronic drums, which is the Roland PD27KV. So these are electronic drums. So I don't manually tune the head, but if I do tune the head, it's not going to affect my tone, right? The tuning range. But it is only going to affect the tension of the massive, the skins that is on this patch here. So if I had to do tuning on the V drum, which is the electronic drum, then I have to go to the module and I can tune the heads to whatever sound I feel is comfortable. So you see? No, but yeah. If you want to talk about basic tuning on acoustic drums,
I also can do.
Okay. This is an electric bass, that's why you also can do from the module there. Okay, but a basic tuning for acoustic drums, you tighten all the LUTs evenly and try to hit on all the edges of the LUTs. And try to get an even tone. And from there, work on to your bottom skin, and you can vary it by having both at the same tension, or one is going higher and lower from the bottom or from the top. So that's the basic tuning method. My next video, where I'm going to use the acoustic kit, I can show you how I tune my drums. Okay? Thank you, Ed. Okay, another question by Chanel. Okay, he's asking if do I have a favorite bass player or does Daniel have a favorite drummer? My favorite bass player is Daniel Giuliano Biasio.
To be fair, my favorite drummer, not fair. Just follow your shit. Don't quit.
All right, whatever you do, don't quit. Everybody is fun to play with, but honestly, Daniel will be one of the best bass players that I've played with, and there are so many more actually. So, like one best bass player, I cannot really answer that question. What about you, Dan?
I think you would rank up there as one of the best I've ever played, and it's a privilege and honor to have you in the same band as well.
Fantastic. Thank you, Dan. Brother. Oh, okay. Yeah. That's from Chanel. Okay, now before. Okay, is there any more comments before we move on? Yeah. Okay, can you read the question again?
What? Nothing much scares us, man. It's just that if we have to do it, then we have to sit down and learn it. Sometimes we are also lazy. So we just don't want to do it because we have a choice. That's a problem also. Sometimes when you have a choice, you don't want to do it, you do. You want to do it, you do. But of course, there's a bad attitude. Don't be like us. And plus, we got stuck during the MCO. We got nothing to do.
Yeah.
And you keep on learning, and you can't even execute them. What's the point? But the point now is, it is relevant to keep on doing what you're doing because it will be over soon, folks. You have to hang in there. I believe so.
So nothing scary.
So nothing can scare us. After MCO, what is that?
It's music. It's music.
Yeah,
you're gonna love music. You know, not taking it as an exam, but it's scary. Right?
Correct.
Okay, now. Okay, last question. Okay. Okay, there's a question from one of my students, which is Pavin, and his dad is asking, do we still practice? And how long do we practice? Is that the question? Okay, do we still practice and how long do we practice? Yes, I still do practice, not every day as for now, but I try to keep practice to. It's good to practice daily because it's something that you love to do, right? If you don't love something that you. If you love something, then you've got to spend time with it, right? It's not because you have to do. So practicing every day is very important. The reason I can't do because I have to look into other things in life, and things are tougher now, so I got to take care of that and make time for my drums too. So how long do I practice? That depends. In my earlier days, I used to practice 4 hours, 8 hours a day. And just doing, remember last week I had a live stream showing you guys how do I do double stroke, right, left. And just doing this on a pillow and just sit at the same tempo, and I will hold it for 4 hours without stopping. So I did my homework like that back then. And as time goes by, things became more easier and more relaxed because I spend the hours. So if you want to get good at something, you got to put in the hours. Because you love it, not because you want to achieve it because it's an exam, like I said. So what about you, Danny?
Like for me, same, you know. I used to put in a lot of hours during my earlier days. Now, I still practice, but just more to keep in touch, you know. And because of the MCO, it doesn't help that, you know, that sometimes you get demotivated, which is sad, but I still have to find a way, and I still keep on playing whenever I'm watching the telly or something. And it's very important to really keep in touch because, like I said, like in order to become a really good rhythm section, you have to just keep on doing what you are doing non-stop. Even if, you know, we have work or no work, this is our passion, right? So you have to keep on doing whatever that stopping you, your double time or anything. You do it until you get it, and just strive and believe that all this will end, you know. That's my wish for everyone out there, not just for us, you know.
Yes, that's the question. Hopefully we answered. And I'm going to add something to that, right? Because in my channel, I try to give some information about what we're doing and also some practicing tips or some lesson that you can take. And if you do the simple stuff, what you can achieve. So before I show you something that I can do on drums, I want Daniel to give you guys a basic lesson of what you can do something. And after putting in the hours practicing, what can you do with that kind of simple stuff? Can you show something to our viewers?
Like for instance, I've been working with my double thumb technique for a long time. Those days, I couldn't really do it, so I kept on doing it for hours and hours until I got it. And it takes a lot of effort and time. I'm still trying to get there, but if you can hear the effect it has when you're doing double thumb, when you play with the drummer. Can I have a beat, please?
All right. You want a straight beat?
Five. One.
Nice. Okay, there's something for you guys to learn. It's called double thumb, right, Daniel? Can you just explain slowly how it's done? What do you actually do?
It's basically it's like you're having a pick in your hand, so it goes like using your thumb. You know?
So it's an up down motion.
If you do it really fast, you can do so many things like all your triplets. That kind of stuff.
Nice. There's something for you guys to take from Daniel about doing double time. So if you like it, try it, because you're going to love it, because it's a process, it's a learning process, and it's a never-ending process. Yeah. Now, he was showing us on how to do up-down motion, right? So based on that, I'm also going to show you a little lesson on this up-down motion that Daniel was explaining to us. So that's the same thing I'm going to do with my right hand. It's called an up-down motion. So it's going to be like this. So hopefully you can see. It's one down, but my wrist is staying down, and the stick is all the way up. And I close it with my finger, and I get another stroke, and I'm coming back to the position where I started. So it's down, the wrist stays down, the stick comes up, and you close your fingers to come back to that V position back again. So you see like a small V and a big V that's happening. So if you work on that, if you want to do double stroke, so it's one down, one up, so right, you get this. So it's less motion and it's very relaxed. Now if I take double stroke roll again and do this open close or up down technique, you can achieve speed in a very comfortable way, and it's sounding very open too. So I'm still using up down motion. And anywhere on the drums you want to go. So that's a simple lesson. Just doing up, down, same like the bass, two thumbs, one down and one up. So that's a simple lesson for you guys to take. Try it at home. See if you can do this kind of stuff, and it's going to help your drumming or your bass playing in the future. Okay? Sat, do you have any more comments? Okay, guys. We're going to say thank you so much for joining in
the
channel. Daniel, thank you so much for
thank you for having me.
It's always been a pleasure to have you.
Always.
Playing with you. Right, and thank you to all the viewers who taken their time. I hope you have learned something, and the idea is to always share, right? So if you like this channel, please don't forget to give me a thumbs up, share this, and subscribe, right? So there's more to come, and follow my Facebook, Instagram. There's more stuff coming up in the soon, so leave me a comment if I need to improve or something, or something else that I can do, okay? So thank you very much. Have a great day. And God bless you all. So we're going to just jam along, and it's going to fade away. Okay? Thank you, guys. One, two, three, go. Thank you, Daniel.
Thank you, Daddy.
It's always been a pleasure.
Yeah, man. So what are you going to do now?
We're going to try.
Okay, you do it.
I don't know. Come on.
Do that. You very good at it.
He's got a very amazing voice. Come on, Dad. 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4.
Go, Tony. Go, Tony. Go, Tony, rap. Go, Tony. Let's hear Do Your Thing.
Oh, my God. I have no idea. You're going to mute me if I rap.
Try it.
They want me to rap, but I can't rap.
Right up.
All I know is couple of songs and they're gonna mute my phone. As I walk to the valley of the shadow of death. As I walk to the valley of the shadow of death. As I walk to